Hello. Thank you for joining us today for our Sunday school lesson study. Let us begin with prayer. Our Father in heaven, we come today to thank you for another day that you have made. We thank you, Father, that you have watched over us throughout last night, and that you have kept us safe, and that you have gotten us up this morning and given us a heart and a mind to praise and to glorify you as we study your holy word. We pray now, Father, that you would help us to set aside any cares and concerns that we might have, and that we may look deeply and intently into your holy word, and that we may find practical applications for our daily lives. We thank you, Father, for this church, the Greater Shiloh Missionary Baptist Church. We thank you, Father, for each and every member. We thank you for those that are in positions of leadership and stewardship. We pray, Father, that you would keep us together as a church family, and that we might become the kind of church that you have called us to be, and that is a Christ-centered church, where others should come to know you through your darling Son, Jesus Christ. We pray now, Father, for those that are sick, those that are afflicted, those that are suffering from the loss of some loved one. We pray, Father, that those that are dealing with the many issues surrounding their lives, the issues of the potential for the increase in inflation, the continuing concern about the economic slowdown, as well as the concern about the global pandemic. We pray, Father, for those that are suffering because of the senseless killings of human beings, Father, as a result of mass shootings in and around our nation. We pray, Father, for those victims that you would continue to bless their families, Father, and that you would comfort them and have them know that you love them and that you promised in your word that you would never leave them, nor will you ever forsake them. We pray also, Father, for the wars that we see going on outside our country. That war that's going on in Ukraine, between Russia and Ukraine. We pray, Father, that you would comfort those that are innocent and that you would hold those accountable, Father, that are guilty, and that those that are accountable must one day stand before your judgment seat and give an account for the deeds done in their bodies. We thank you, Father, most of all for your darling Son, Jesus Christ, who because of his life, his death, his burial, and his resurrection, now through faith in him, Father, we too can have that life, and we can have it more abundantly, as you promised in your holy word. We pray that you will continue to keep us safe. In Jesus' precious name we pray. Amen. Again, I say thank you for joining us for our Sunday school lesson study as we continue in our summer 2023 quarterly study, which has been entitled The Righteous Reign of God. And so we've been looking at Unit 1 series of lessons, which are entitled The Prophets Proclaim God's Power. And so that brings us down to our June 11th lesson 2. Which is entitled God's Kingdom of Peace, as we study from Isaiah chapter 65, verses 17 through 25 of the New International Version of the Bible. And if you look on our screen, you see that our lesson today is divided into two teaching outlines. Our first outline is celebrating newness in Isaiah chapter 65, verses 17 through 19. Our second outline is the new reality in Isaiah chapter 65, verses 20 through 25. And all our scripture will come from the New International Version of the Bible. And so let's look on our screen and let's read our lesson scripture for today as we read from Isaiah chapter 65, verses 17 through 25 of the New International Version of the Bible, and it's entitled New Heavens and a New Earth. So let's begin reading at verse 17. See, I will create new heavens and a new earth. The former things will not be remembered, nor will they come to mind. But be glad and rejoice forever in what I will create. For I will create Jerusalem to be a delight, and its people a joy. I will rejoice over Jerusalem and take delight in my people. The sound of weeping and of crying will be heard in it no more. Never again will there be in it an infant who lives but a few days, or an old man who does not live out his years. The one who dies at 100 will be thought a mere child. The one who fails to reach 100 will be considered accursed. They will build houses and dwell in them. They will plant vineyards and eat their fruit. No longer will they build houses and others live in them, or plant and others eat. For as the days of a tree, so will be the days of my people. My chosen ones will long enjoy the work of their hands. They will not labor in vain, nor will they bear children doomed to misfortune. For they will be a people blessed by the Lord. They and their descendants with them. But they will call, and I will answer. While they are still speaking, I will hear. The wolf and the lamb will feed together, and the lion will eat straw like the ox. The dust will be the serpent's food. They will neither harm nor destroy on all my holy mountain, says the Lord. This is the word of God for the people of God. Thanks be unto God. And so next we have our lesson context, part A, as we read from our lesson context, which is on our screen, which has to do with God's kingdom of peace, as we've been reading about the new heavens and a new earth from Isaiah chapter 65, verses 17 through 25 of the New International Version of the Bible. So let's read our lesson context part A together, which is on our screen. Isaiah chapter 63 through 66, which is entitled God's Day of Vengeance and Redemption, is identifiable as a unit of thought. These chapters echo the problems of human failure addressed in Isaiah chapter 56 through chapter 59, which is entitled Salvation for Others. But they don't stop there. Isaiah chapter 63 through chapter 66 goes on to add elements of hope because of the power of God. In so doing, Isaiah chapter 66, chapter 63 through chapter 66, contrast human inability to be righteous with God's divine ability to produce righteousness. The backdrop is again that of what the people in Babylonian captivity, several decades into the future from the time of Isaiah, prophesies, would need as hopeful assurance of better days, as we looked at lesson one from last week's study. When we speak of the Babylonian exile, we take care to distinguish it from the Assyrian exile of the 10 tribes of northern Israel in 722 BC, which can be found in 2 Kings chapter 17, verse 6. The two tribes of southern Israel, collectively known as Judah, came under Babylonian dominance in about 609 BC from 2 Kings chapter 24, verses 1 through 7. The Babylonians, also known as the Chaldeans, tightened the screws in 597 BC when Jerusalem surrendered after a siege and suffered a partial exile. In 2 Kings chapter 24, verse 20. The final straw was the wholesale deportation or exile of Judah to Babylon in 586 BC. The impact of that exile can be seen by piecing together the text, among others, of 2 Kings chapter 25, Second Chronicles chapters 36 through verses, chapter 36, verse 15 through 21. Nehemiah chapter 1, verse 1, 2, and 3. Psalms number 137. Jeremiah chapter 15. And Lamentations chapters 1 through 5. As well as Ezekiel chapter 4, verses 1 through chapter 24, verse 14. Daniel chapter 1, verses 1 through verse 2, and Daniel chapter 9, verses 1 through 19. In particular, the last of these passages notes that 1, Jerusalem desolation would last 70 years. 2, the people of Judah and Jerusalem had brought that destruction on themselves by refusing to obey God. 3, the curses poured out on the Judeans were exactly what had been predicted in the law of Moses. And 4, God had kept his promise to inflict such punishment. The prediction of punishment via exiles are found in Leviticus chapter 26, verses 27 through 33, Deuteronomy chapter 4, verses 25 through 28, and Deuteronomy chapter 28, verses 64 through 68. Also, you can compare Nehemiah chapter 1, verse 8, Jeremiah chapter 9, verses 13 through 16, chapter 15, verses 1 through 2, and verse 14, the book of Ezekiel chapter 12, verse 15, chapter 20, verse 23 through 24, and the book of Zechariah, chapter 7, verse 13 through 14. And so next we look at on our screen a book of the book of Isaiah Bible timeline. Now this is something we had on last week's study, so you should have already have this slide, but I wanted to put it in this particular lesson two, to show you that this lesson two, comes from the same general topic of Isaiah prophesying concerning Judah's captivity and restoration, as we look at beginning in Isaiah chapter 40 through Isaiah chapter 66. And so this particular prophecy by Isaiah came about somewhere around 711 BC, and this was years before, hundreds of years before the captivity and the restoration ever occurred. But Isaiah could see through the inspiration of the Holy Spirit and could present this prophecy to the people of God, because Isaiah was a prophet, a true prophet of the Lord, that spoke what thus said the Lord. And so let's look at this celebration or celebrating newness that would come about when Israel, the nation of Judah, the southern kingdom, is released from Babylonian captivity and begin to return back into their homeland of Jerusalem in the region of Judah. And so that brings us to Isaiah chapter 65, verses 17 through 19. And our first subtopic has the reason for their rejoicing, as we look at verse 17, which deals with the source of rejoicing. And so let's read verse 17 together, which is on our screen. See, I will create new heavens and a new earth. The former things will not be remembered, nor will they come to mind. And so we see in verse 17a that Isaiah chapter 65, verse 17 begins by describing a radically different future reality for these enslaved Jews that would be taken into Babylonian captivity. Does this verse, though, refer to the ultimate new creation that God will bring about at the end of the time, which we read about in Revelation chapter 21? But we also can see that similar wording is in 2 Peter chapter 3, verse 13, as well as in Revelation chapter 21, verse 1, which could tempt us to think so as we compare and contrast Isaiah chapter 66, verse 22, and Hebrews chapter 12, verse 25 through 27. But the opening word here, see, in Hebrews chapter 12, verse 25 through 27, leads us to reconsider our first thoughts. See appears also in Isaiah chapter 26, verse 3, chapter 40, verse 7, and chapter 43, verse 20, where the translation of the word see is because, as in here's the reason why. So because, the word because of the word see, connects the thoughts of verse 17a with those of the previous verses. In the previous verses in Isaiah chapter 65, it announces two things. One would be the end of foreign domination of Israel from Isaiah chapter 48, verses 14 and verse 20, regarding Babylon, and Isaiah chapter 52, verse 4, regarding Assyria. And number two, the end of unholy rebellion by the Israelites in Isaiah chapter 65, verses 11 and 12. The end of imperial aggression would mean make such a dramatic change that the language of a new creation is appropriate for it. When added to the extreme language regarding elimination of unholiness and end-time interpretation of the destruction and the replacement of planet Earth is very inviting. Two other options, though, should be considered also. One is that this particular prophecy could have a double fulfillment, maybe what's intended. The first fulfillment would focus on ancient Israel, and it sees the language as being figurative and hyperbolic. The second fulfillment is then end time, literally, would be the end times as we see in Revelation chapter 21, which would be the literal translation. Another option, though, is that the text in Isaiah chapter 65, verse 17, could likely feature what is known as prophetic foreshortening, as we see in Zechariah chapter 9, verse 9. The verses that follow, though, in today's study will provide clues as to which interpretation is more likely the correct one. Or it could be all of those interpretations, because clearly God is capable. God is who he says he is, and God can do anything he wants to do. And he can also have Isaiah prophesy concerning things that would be closely to the immediate future, but also things that would be out in the distant future of God's people's lives. And so we see here that in verse 17b, a feature of this new era or of this restoration period would be a kind of forgetting. The type of forgetting in view is the kind when an event or an experience would fade into the background because something more important has taken its place or has replaced it. And that more important thing is that this is an image of the end of Israel's suffering at the hands of the Babylonians, as well as Israel's suffering at the hands of the Assyrians. And so this would call for rejoicing as we look at verse 18, which is on our screen. And so let's read verse 18 together. But be glad and rejoice forever in what I will create. For I will create Jerusalem to be a delight and its people a joy. Now, verse 18a, the command to be glad and rejoice forever is built into Old Testament religious expression. It is an attitude that rests on confidence in God's sure promise to overcome evil in its various forms. And we can count on God's sure promise. If what he says he could do, he will certainly do it. But he will do it in his own time because he is sovereign. And so we see that it is the wording here forever may signify age enduring or to the end of the age, as we see in Psalms number 132, verse 12. Now in verse 18b, we see that the hope for rebuilding Jerusalem occupied the thoughts of the poet, the prophets, and other leaders in that particular period, especially as we look at Nehemiah chapter 1, as also as we study from the book of Ezra. And Nehemiah chapter 1 is an example of the rebuilding of Jerusalem, as Nehemiah had a desire to rebuild a wall that had been torn down and had been laid idle for such a long period of time. And so because the city and its destroyed temple represented access to God, Jerusalem was, or it should have been, a symbol of all that could be holy, as we read in Revelations chapter 21, verse 2. Our next topic has to do with promise of rejoicing in Isaiah chapter 65, verse 19. So let's read verse 19, which is on our screen. I will rejoice over Jerusalem and take delight in my people. The sound of weeping and of crying will be heard in it no more. In verse 19a, God himself can join in the celebration, as we see in Zephaniah chapter 3, verse 17. The relationship between Judah and God will have changed. The strains and mutual hostility brought about by the people's sin will have vanished thanks to God's merciful forgiveness and his gracious restoration of them back into their homeland. And so we see in verse 19 other means of rejoicing, in that the sound of weeping is to disappear because of the forthcoming change of the relationship between God and his people. The destruction of Jerusalem and other cities there in the southern kingdom of Judah resulted in intense grief and mourning. Reversal of those facts seem impossible for a human viewpoint, but not from God's viewpoint, as we see in Isaiah chapter 25, verse 8, also in the book of Revelations chapter 17, verse 7, and Revelations chapter 21, verse 4. And so we see now that God is promising these returning exiles from the Babylonian captivity a new reality, as we read from Isaiah chapter 65, verses 20 through 25, with our first topic being that of this new reality being long life from verse 20. So let's read verse 20, which is on our screen. Never again will there be in it an infant who lives but a few days, or an old man who does not live out his years. The one who dies at 100 will be thought a mere child. The one who fails to reach 100 will be considered accursed. And this word accursed has to do with something or someone that is under a curse or a spell, or they just seem like it. And so we see that the new reality in verse 20a is to come is to differ from the old reality in important ways. And the first way is that it would be that of long life, as was experienced in Genesis chapters 1 through 11 before the fall of the man and the woman. The life expectancy promised in verse 20a, which is long life, is a major one, as we see in Zechariah chapter 8, verse 4. The new heaven and the new earth promised in Isaiah chapter 65, verse 17, are not the same as those predicted in Peter's book, 2 Peter chapter 3, verse 13, or in the book of Revelation by the Apostle John, chapter 21, verse 21. Since the renewal in those two passages that we just referenced will feature an end of death altogether, as we see in Revelation chapter 21, verse 4. The new heavens and the new earth that's promised in Isaiah chapter 65, verse 17, may serve as a type or a pattern of the ultimate eternal reality that all God's Christians, all believers in Jesus Christ will experience, that will come one day, as we see in Matthew chapter 11, verse 13 through 14. Paul writes in Romans chapter 5, verse 14, as well as Paul writes in Galatians chapter 4, verse 24, in Colossians chapter 2, verse 17. The writer to the Hebrews in Hebrews chapter 9, verse 24, and Hebrews chapter 13, verse 14. And so in Isaiah chapter 65, verse 17 through 21, it provides us with a launching point for anticipating the fulfillment of Revelation chapter 21, when God will certainly bring about a new heaven and a new earth, and God will dwell with his people in that new heaven and that new earth for all eternity. So God has promised to create a new heaven and a new earth, and this one that he's talking about would be absent of weeping, as well as it would be absent of death in verse 28. Now in verse 20b, the Hebrew verb here in the phrase translated, the one who fails to reach, can also be translated miss, as it is in Judges chapter 20, verse 16. Therefore, the idea is that someone who missed the mark of reaching age 100 is to be considered a curse, or that is someone that is under a curse or a spell, or it just seems like it. In that case, the line would simply amplify the idea of the previous verses that we read in Isaiah chapter 65, rather than adding a new idea. And so now we look at verse 21 and the promise of housing, as well as sustenance of food and shelter to provide for these returning exiles from Babylonian captivity. Bear in mind that they have not gone into captivity yet. It would be over 100 and some years before they would go. And when they go, they would stay there some 70 years. But ultimately, God promised to restore them back into their homeland and to rebuild their homeland in the city of Jerusalem, as well as in the nation of Judah. And so let's read about this substance and this housing in Isaiah chapter 21, which is on our screen. I'm sorry, Isaiah chapter 65, verse 21. They will build houses and dwell in them. They will plant vineyards and eat their fruit. And so we see in verse 21 that the ruins of Judah had rendered stark testimony of their disobedience long after the destruction of the city of Jerusalem by the Babylonian king Nebuchadnezzar in 586 BC. As we read in 1 Kings chapter 9, verses 6 through 9, also Jeremiah, who was there when Babylon came in and captured Jerusalem and Judah, we read about in Jeremiah chapter 19, verse 8, as well as in Isaiah here, chapter 65, verses 17 through 25. And so Isaiah chapter 65, verse 17 through 25, promised that those returning from exile in Babylon would gain stable and productive lives. The mention of vineyards reflect an important part of the diet and the economy of the ancient Israelites, as we'll read in Ezekiel chapter 28, verse 26, and Amos chapter 9, verse 14. And so our third section here has to do with section C, which is safety and security, as we read verses 22 and 23, which are on our screen. And so let's read verses 22 and 23 together. No longer will they build houses and others live in them, or plant and others eat. For as the days of a tree, so will be the days of my people, my chosen ones, will long enjoy the work of their hands. They will not labor in vain, nor will they bear children doomed to misfortune. For they will be a people blessed by the Lord, they and their descendants with them. And so now we see in verse 22a of today's study that the results of the Babylonian exile of 586 BC included that the Jews or the Israelites there from Jerusalem as well as from the surrounding cities in Judah would have lost or would have been as far as we can tell, would have lost of houses, as well as their fields, which became occupied and was tended by others that Jeremiah writes about in Jeremiah chapter 52, verse 16. And Jeremiah was one of the prophets that was there when the when Jerusalem fell in 586 BC and was taken captivity into Babylon. And so Jeremiah writes about this in Jeremiah chapter 52, verse 16, and I quote, "But Nebuchadnezzar left behind the rest of the poorest people of the land to work the vineyards and the fields." So only the poor was left there, and they was left there pretty much as slaves, but left in their hometown of Jerusalem. But they were left there to work the fields and to tend for the land for those that would come in and occupy the land, as Nebuchadnezzar would deport and exile the best and brightest from Jerusalem and only leave the poorest there, but he would bring in, which was a traditional tactic of those conquering kings, would bring in other nations to occupy the land. And so we see here that the devastation was so complete that areas of human habitation began again, where animals began to habit, the wild animals began to inhabit the land. As Jeremiah will also write in Jeremiah chapter 9, verse 11, and I quote, Jeremiah is quoting, and he was also a prophet of the Lord, and he's speaking what thus said the Lord. And so he's quoting, he says, God in saying that, "I will make Jerusalem a heap of ruins, a haunt of jackals, and I will lay rest the towns of Judah so no one can live there." And this was all because Judah had turned their backs on God, and they had been going after idol gods. They had been worshiping the gods of those heathens. And they had been causing havoc and mistreating the poor and the homeless and the widows of their own people. And so God had sent prophet after prophet to warn them concerning this devastation. But they ignored God and they continued down that path. To God had to, because God is holy, he has to punish the sin. And so he allowed them to be taken captivity into Babylon for 70 years, but he also promised them that he would restore them back after the captivity was over. And so we see also the same concern about Jeremiah in Jeremiah chapter 10, verse 2. God had kept his promise concerning what he would do because they had gone after idol gods and they had forsaken him. But God also promised that he would reverse that devastation. And so we see in verse 22b that the theme of reversal of the devastation in Judah continues as the imagery shift to the longevity from the phrase, the longevity of the people that will be restored back into the land, based on the phrase, days of a tree. The promise that my chosen ones will long enjoy the work of their hands coupled with longevity of life, with enjoyment of that life, creating a word picture of a people who will flourish, as we see in Psalms chapter number 1, verses 1, verse 3, and Psalms number 92, verses 12 through 14. And so God does fulfill his promise in allowing them to go into captivity, But he's also speaking through the prophet Isaiah to tell them that one day they're going to return back to their homeland and they're going to flourish when they return. And so we see now in verse 23 that Isaiah chapter 65, verse 23, ties together Isaiah chapter 65, verses 21 through 22 in summarizing the restored condition of God's people. The loss of sons and daughters was predicted as an anguish of the exile. Moses had foretold them before it ever occurred, before they ever got into the land, the curses for ignoring God and turning toward those idols that they would find in this new land, the promised land. He had warned them in Deuteronomy chapter 28, verse 32, as well as verse 41, if they turn their backs on God, it would result in them being deported out of this promised land, and that they would be taken captive by those heathen nations that surrounded them. And so again, we have this promise that they would be restored back into their homeland. So Isaiah chapter 49, verses 19 through 21, and chapter 54, verses 1 and 2, we note that there is a surprise and a joy at the uptick of the birth rate as the text predicts the situation of the post-exile area, which would be from after their return from Babylonian captivity in 538 BC. Now, during the 40-year penalty of wandering in the wilderness, which was about 1447 to 1407 BC, Israel had also at that time experienced a decline in their population. As Moses numbered the population when they came out of Egypt, in Numbers chapter 2, verse 32, there was some 603,550 men. By the time they come to Numbers chapter 26, verse 51, the population has decreased to 601,730 men. But now God's promising that that population would flourish again as Judah returns to their homeland and God restores them back into Jerusalem. And so we see that any nation, even the nation of America, cannot survive, much less flourish, unless they bring a new generation into the world. Children are a sign of hope and blessing, as we see in Psalms number 128, as well as they are tokens of God's presence, both in the present and in the promised future, as we see in Isaiah chapter 61, verse 9. And so now we see that the relationship between God and his people in this restored situation will improve in that God will once again answer their prayers, as we read verse 24, which is on our screen. Before they call, I will answer. While they are still speaking, I will hear. And so we see in verse 24 that the restoration of God's people will see deep and immediate communication between God and his people. And we can compare that in Jeremiah chapter 7, verse 6, chapter 11, verse 14, chapter 14, verse 11, as well as in Lamentations chapter 3, verse 8, and verse 44. While they were worrying and being concerned and worshiping these idol gods, God refused to answer their prayers. He refused to listen to them because they had rejected him. And so now, after they have gone into captivity because of their disobedience to the Lord, and God restores them now, he's saying here that he will answer their prayers once again, in that before they call, I will answer. And while they are still speaking, I will hear. And so the book of Isaiah opens with condemnation of the people because of their stubbornness and their oppression, and their acts of piety were mere design to cover up their sins rather than lead them to correct them, as we see in Isaiah chapter 1, verse 12 through 17, which caused great offense between God and his people, since they would not defend the poor, the widows, or the orphan. God would not even give ear to their prayers, as we see in Isaiah chapter 1, verse 15. Their restoration was to be one where God listens intently to their prayers. In extending mercy to the people, God has called them to make prayer an occasion for concern. When we pray properly, we become attuned to God's love for all human beings. We increasingly share that concern and act on that concern based on it. Then God will listen to us. And so we see also in our last verse, verse 25, there will be an end to the violence that they had experienced and that when they are restored back into their homeland. So let's read verse 25, end of violence, which is on the screen. The wolf and the lamb will feed together, and the lion will eat straw like the ox, and dust will be the serpent's food. They will neither harm nor destroy on all my holy mountains, says the Lord. And so Isaiah chapter 65, verse 25, reflects what Isaiah had prophesied in Isaiah chapter 11, verse 6 through 9, when he speaks about the branch that would come from the seed of Jesse, when he's talking about Jesus would come down through the lineage of King David, down through the lineage of Jesse, David's father, and ultimately that Jesus would be the one that would be that branch that brings about this peaceable kingdom. And so we see that this verse speaks of visions of a peaceable kingdom. So in Isaiah chapter 65, verse 25, it applies that early vision to the time when Israel will have returned from the Babylonian exile and resettled in its land, which would be after 538 BC and their 70 years of exile in Babylon. In doing so, that vision paints a strong contrast to what would become the actual experience of God's people. Old problems would remain or resurface after their return to Babylon, as we see in Ezra chapter 10, verses 10 through 15. Also in Nehemiah chapter 13, in Haggai, the book of Haggai chapter 1, verse 1 through 11, as well as other Old Testament prophecies like the book of Malachi. And so yet this sinful problem need not prevail with the Israelites. If the people turn back to God fully, a new era of peace could ensure. Isaiah chapter 25 intends to speak about a reality that should ideally come about. Yet that possibility remains always just beyond our reach or our grasp, as we do not yet live in this peaceable kingdom, God's peaceable kingdom, physically live in it. In Isaiah chapter 65, verse 25, it calls its readers, or it calls the people of God, to pursue righteousness and peace so that we may draw closer to God's kingdom of peace, in which God reigns not just in the world, as he always does, but he also in our thoughts and our action, which he often does not reign. And so let's conclude our lesson today with embracing life. And let's read our conclusion on the screen. Isaiah chapter 65 is a visionary text that should inspire God's people to see beyond both past failures and the seemingly valid temptation of the present. It invites us to imagine a different world than the one we inherit, a world in which old wounds will be healed and the God-given talent of all are used to bless others. This text offers a vision of a world in which the communication between God and his people remains open, free, and life-giving. Reading a visionary text means that we have to think creatively in a biblical way. Such texts cause us to use our imaginations, so we can begin to see what God might be creating in our lives as individuals and churches. In such a vision, God is the one who does the creating. The language of creation does not apply just to the beginning of time, but to a new era that can emerge when people who have experienced God's mercy embrace the possibilities of a new and holy ways of life. Isaiah chapter 65, verse 17 through 25. Advances that move in a dramatic way. It does not portray the citizens of Jerusalem and Judah as being able by their own power to bring about a new world God seeks. Sometimes they fall back into the same sins that led their ancestors to lose their homeland. So if a new situation were to come about, God must be the one to bring it about. This vision is an alternative world. This vision of an alternative world continues to exert enormous influence on Christians today. Texts like Isaiah chapter 65, verses 17 through 25 reminds us that the current reality is neither inevitable nor the full expression of God's plan for humankind. More is possible. Imagining that something more and celebrating even small hints of its arrival in our everyday life makes the community of God's people what it is. And so let's close today's lesson with our thought for the day, which says, live as if the time of the new heaven and new earth were now. Jesus says in John chapter 14, verse 27, peace I leave with you. My peace I give you. I do not give to you as the world gives. Do not let your heart be troubled and do not be afraid. Let us pray. Father in heaven, we thank you for your word. As we have studied from the book of Isaiah and we have read your promise of certainly captivity, but more important, your promise of restoration. And Father, we understand that one day we will live in a peaceful physical kingdom when your darling son Jesus comes back. But we also can live in a peaceful kingdom now as we allow Jesus to enter into our hearts, into our thoughts, and into our minds. For he says he brings us peace, he gives us peace, not as the world gives to us. And so, Father, help us to accept the peace of your Son, Jesus Christ, and to be indwelled by his Holy Spirit, and to be willing to show that love and that peace toward others as we continue our life here on earth and we wait for the physical creation of a new heaven and a new earth. In Jesus' precious name we pray, amen. May God continue to bless and keep you safe is my prayer. Have a great day.
Oh, there will be peace in the valley for me. One day there will be peace in the valley for me. I pray.
Oh, no sadness, no sorrow. No more trouble, there will be
peace in the valley,
in the valley for me.
Oh, you know the bear will be gentle, you know the wolves gonna be so tame. Mighty lion, he will lie down with a lamb. Oh yes, I know the host from the wild will be led by a little child, and I'll be changed from this creature.
Peace, child,
in the valley
for me. so
there'll be
peace
in the valley.
Trouble there will be
peace in the valley.